Thank you, sir. Thank you, Vijayashekhar, sir, for those kind words. And thank you, IAPT NSE, for this opportunity. And today, as said before, I'm going to talk about management of under 5Es. So here it will be a broad outline and only the concepts behind it, and not the minute intricacies which we are going to see. And this is from a practitioner's perspective I'm going to talk. Most of the time when we talk about bees or asthma, there is always a confusion nowadays, okay, because too much of hype. Even now, it's not given as asthma, it's given it as under 5Es. So there is a confusion in the practitioners between preschool visas and older kinder with bees. And they think it's a different ballgame. Of course, yes, but not a totally different ballgame. And management of acute and recurrent bees, how to go about, is a confusion. And whether nebulizers or MDI with spacer without mask is a question. And when to use the controllers and bronchodilators or the relievers. And overall, when we talk about controllers, the immediate thing that strikes everyone is your steroid phobia and addiction to inhalers. And of course, when we deal with asthma, there is a lot of time constraint because you need to have time to explain to the parent, convince them, and also motivate them to go ahead with controller medication. So the focus as a practitioner, I'll be dealing with 7 topics. That is, can young children have bees? Can young children have asthma? Clinical manifestation, risk factors, when to investigate, when to treat, why to treat, and how to treat. So these will be in a broader perspective and nutshell that we are going to deal today. So now, can young children have bees? See, bees is due to narrowing or compressed of the airway, compression of the airway. Of course, every human being has an airway. So by all ways and means, they can also get compressed or narrowed. So that can always result in bees. So there is no doubt, irrespective of age, people can have bees, which also includes your younger children. And it is one of the common presenting symptoms in younger age group. And 10 to 15% of infant bees during first year of life. And they say 1 in every 3 children experience bees in first 3 years of life, by first 3 years of life. With 30% experiencing beesing, only 20% among them will experience bees in later age. Meaning, that's what we traditionally call the outgrow asthma. Some will manifest, some may not manifest. So can young children have asthma? So children with recurrent wheezing are likely to have asthma. Asthma is not a single disease. It's a disorder with what? Vast heterogeneity in pathogenicity, severity, and treatment response. So it is basically a phenotypic approach and diagnosis. So with regards to younger children, before labeling it as asthma, we need to have a phenotypic approach. Then we need to see if there are any other alternative diagnoses which are mimicking asthma. If not so, then with reasonable surety, we can call them as asthma, irrespective of their age. And with regards to the clinical manifestation, I'm not going to talk about signs and symptoms of airflow obstruction. Here, we'll broadly see into 2 scenarios. One is the first episode of bees. The other one is the recurrent bees. These are the common scenarios which we see in less than 5 years of the preschool visas. The first episode of bees, traditionally, everybody thinks it is 100% bronchiolitis. Of course, yes, bronchiolitis is top on the card. That alone is not in the card. It can also be the first viral induced wheezing, or it could be the first manifestation of asthma. Remember, we writing case sheet or also going through the case sheet, many people say the child with recurrent bees was admitted. In the past history, they say was admitted with bronchiolitis at 6 months of age or 8 months of age. So probably in that scenario, that could have been a bronchiolitis, or that could have been the first episode of bees itself in that particular child. So this is what I'm trying to reinforce. With regards to recurrent bees, what is recurrent? Recurrent meaning 3 or more episode of wheezing in 1 year age is considered to be recurrent bees. That is a reasonable accepted definition for now. And then I told you about phenotypic diagnosis. Phenotypic diagnosis meaning etiopathogenesis can be many, but that's the manifestation which we see clinically. That is called the phenotypic diagnosis. There are 2 types, episodic viral visas and multi-trigger visas. Episodic viral visas are common in children where with a viral infection, that is cold, cough, with or without fever, the child tend to have bees, and they are usually normal in between these episodes. That is a episodic visa or episodic viral induced visas. Multi-trigger wheezing in sense, wheezing both during exacerbation and between episodes also they can have some symptoms, and the trigger can be many. It can be even a viral infection, or it can be some allergen like your dusting at home or fungal molds or exercise or some irritants like cigarette smoke or triggers. So overall, preschool wheezers is divided into two broad phenotypic variety, that is the episodic wheezer and multi-trigger wheezer. This was previously said to be transient wheezer, persistent wheezer, and late onset wheezer. The problem with the bottom classification is you can label them in retrospect as what they are. Supposing a 6-month-old child come to you with the second episode of wheeze, you won't be able to say whether it is transient, persistent, or late onset. So it is a retrospective diagnosis, whereas the current diagnosis or the running commentary would be your episodic or your multi-trigger wheeze. So these phenotypes are interchangeable and they are not always stable, and there are multiple contributing factors other than your genetics that is being contributed from the environmental pressures. So the viral infections are the common thing which triggers a wheeze. Most of the time when we say viruses, we always think in terms of only RSV, but the most common one is the human rhinovirus. And rhinovirus, there are more than 100 serotypes and they don't have any cross protection. That's why you can have a running nose now and you can also have a running nose after 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So that by itself can trigger an episode of wheeze. And this, most of the time, it is common, viral triggered wheeze is common in children, but this can also happen in older children and in adults by 50%. So what are the risk factors for asthma? The moment we say risk factors, we talk about modified asthma predictive index, that is more than 4 episodes with 1 major or 2 minor criteria. The major and minor criteria are episodes of eczema or parental asthma or allergic sensitization to either a aero allergen or a food allergen, and also eosinophil percent more than 4 in that particular child. But here the problem is a positive asthma predictive index substantially increases the probability of future asthma, but a negative index does not mean that the child will never have an asthma. So it is just like placing a blind bet. Just because the asthma predictive index is positive, you cannot vouch and say you are going to be an asthmatic and put on any intervention. Just because it is negative, you cannot say you will never develop an asthma and leave them scot-free. So it is only over a period of time you need to wait and watch how things unfold for you. And overall, now the recent understanding is a child who is a recurrent wheezer in early childhood, if it continues to wheeze even in future or later childhood, that is called as a true asthma. If there is going to be a component of atopy in the child, this is called an atopic asthma. Otherwise, overall, it is only the persistent of symptom or wheeze manifesting over a period of time. So with regards to risk factors, as clinician, what we should be worried is, if there is frequent symptoms of wheeze in the first year of life, or if there is an eczema in the child, or if there is an elevated IgE, or a maternal history of asthma or maternal smoking, these are probably an increased risk factor for the child predisposing to asthma later in their life. So when do we investigate? So asthma, as I said, is a clinical diagnosis. Most of the time, nothing is required. Investigation are reserved, more so in younger children, to diagnose mimics. If there are red flags, we'll see what red flags are. And to see the severity and certainty of the persons of comorbid condition. And in real difficult situation where we are not able to differentiate what is what with recurrent wheezing. So the red flags here are daily moist or productive cough. Antony is there, and any child with running nose or sneeze right from birth, also think in terms of primary ciliary dyskinesia. Children with feeding difficulty, choking, drooling, any chest pain, exertional dyspnea, hemoptysis, change in the voice. Any noisy breathing, don't take it for granted. Don't always label it as laryngomalacia. Any child with a voice change, persisting voice change, any voice change more than 1 week or 10 days, better be careful. And any child with failure to thrive or not gaining adequate weight, or auscultatory finding either in the CVS or RS, any child with digital clubbing or persistent hypoxia or cyanosis, these are the red flag signs. You have to be doubly sure, and these are the group where we cannot label them as asthma, even if they present as asthma as an add-on or a additional asthma presentation and not a basic diagnosis of asthma. And we have to be careful with any children with orofacial anomaly and any child with thoracic skeletal abnormality, any child with neuromuscular or neurodevelopmental anomaly, and any other multisystem disorders or an immunodeficiency in them. Before labeling it as asthma, you have to be careful that there can be many other etiology operating in them, which are manifesting with recurrent wheeze. So you always remember about the red flags before we label it as asthma, irrespective of age, more so in younger children less than 5 years of age. And the investigations, most of the time what we do is DC, ESR, MAN2 and the IgE with a chest X-ray. And MAN2, here it tells you it's a TB infection, but it will not tell you whether it is an asthma or not. And ATT should be reserved only to TB infection and for TB disease. And increased eosinophil and skin test for RAST and IgE just tells you there is an atopic tendency. This again has to be correlated with symptoms. And diethyl carbamazepine is used as an anti-eosinophilic drug, whereas it is an anti-filarial drug where filariasis can cause increased eosinophil count. So these things we have to have in mind. And chest X-rays are not diagnostic of asthma. And they can have a normal X-ray, you can have an hyperaerated X-ray, or a perihilar infiltrate or a microatelectasis. Hyperaeration just tells you there is significant air trapping, and rarely with complicated asthma acute exacerbation, there can be secondary pneumonia, atelectasis, or air leak. And many of the time when we take children X-ray with wheeze, you tend to see some perihilar or parahilar infiltrates, more so in younger children. That is because the pores of Pohn, that is intraalveolar pores, or pores of Lambert, that is the alveolar bronchial connections, which provides collateral for airway aeration, are underdeveloped, more so in children less than 3 to 4 years of age. Because of that, there is no collateral air circulation. So when that particular place is blocked, there is mucus plugging and microatelectasis. This leads on to a lot of microatelectic changes, which mimics like a pneumonia. That's what we call it as a bronchopneumonic picture. So we have to be careful on that. When do we treat? Here, treatment is, we all know about asthma qualifiers and we all know about recurrent wheezes. Here, we treat wheezing only for if there is a recurrent wheeze component or if there is an exacerbation to it. Recurrent wheeze in young children, look for alternative diagnosis and also watch out for red flags. In recurrent wheeze with qualifiers, I'll tell you what the qualifiers are. In case if there is a recurrent wheeze in younger children without qualifiers, and if it is severe, meaning they are getting admitted more than once, or if it is persistent, even between episodes, they are not totally fine. And if there are frequent episodes, that is more than one episode in a month or more than three in a season, meaning if they are getting almost every month symptom despite their recurrent background, then even without qualifiers, you can treat them like asthma. So the qualifiers for asthma are recurrent wheezes with afebrile episode or personal or family atopy of asthma, nocturnal exacerbation, exercise-induced or activity-induced symptom, trigger-induced symptom like smoke and other irritants, seasonal exacerbation, relief with bronchodilator with or without oral steroids. This is the traditional one which you all know. With regards to persistent asthma, overall, if you see all the recommendation, including the GINA, which keeps changing every year, it leads on to a lot of confusion. Less than 2 times, 3 times, 4 times. What we are talking about, nobody knows. When we are classifying, we cannot be having a tabular column by the side and correlating with the child symptom. Overall, the conceptually, we need to know this is assessed over a period of time. The reasonable period of time would be the last 3 months at least. That is the level of memory which we can rely upon when with regards to the history with certainty. If it is an intermittent asthma, we have to have 4 qualifiers, meaning it has to be occasional, brief, mild, and non-life-threatening. So if one of the 4 is not being met out properly, then we have to call them as persistent symptom. So what are these 4? To have certain objectivity, occasional meaning it is not more than 1 per month or less than 2 in 3 months, meaning you are not having more than or equal to 1 every month. and it has to be brief episode, 4 to 5 days, and it should be mild, meaning it should not be affecting your sleep, play, eating, or your school attendance, and it should not be life-threatening. Life-threatening meaning it should not warrant a hospitalization or ER visit other than anxiety purpose. If it is for a real medical indication, then probably it is taken as life-threatening, right? So occasional, brief, mild, and non-life-threatening. Say, for example, even if you're having recurrent wheeze, you have the last wheeze more than 6 months ago, but still if it is going to be an acute severe exacerbation requiring hospitalization, for all practical purposes, you'd be categorized as persistent symptom and not as an intermittent symptom. That is one thing important. And with regards to exacerbation, this is one thing where the parent themselves will want you to treat. Any presence or worsening of signs and symptoms of airflow obstruction, which was not there before, is considered to be exacerbation. And it can happen secondary to an external agent like your infection or pollution, or it could be because of poor adherence to control. In some, without any known risk factors, just like that, it can manifest with exacerbation. Irrespective of whatever, exacerbation is exacerbation, and frequent presentation warrants controller medication. And why to treat and how to treat? Why to treat, in sense, you should have a symptom-free good quality of life, and you should have a normal life pattern, normal growth and development, minimal use of relievers, and minimal side effect because of the medicine in which we are using. So in less than 5 years, what has been said is, always start with low dose inhaled corticosteroid, then double the dose. Whereas in older children, we tend to add LABA. In younger children, LABA doesn't come first in the role. We always start with low dose of steroid, then we up the dose of steroid. Then we can add a LTRA to it. Then if it still doesn't subside, then as a last resort, we can look in for a role of LABA, though that's not been straightforwardly approved by guidelines. So with regards to inhaled steroids, what we should understand is just by increasing the dose of inhaled steroids, you will not be able to control all symptoms of asthma. So the maximum dose of steroid in younger children less than 12 years with regards to budesonide is 400, with regards to fluticasone is 200. Whereas in more than 12 years, with regards to budesonide, it is 800, and fluticasone, it is 500. So never breach this dose with regards to the steroid inhalers, which we use as a controller. That is one thing which we have to remember. Overall, with regards to preschool wheezing, first episode in a nutshell, first episode, always give a trial of bronchodilator. If it responds, you proceed like any other wheeze. If it doesn't respond, systematic care with as like bronchiolitis. With regards to recurrent episode in an younger age group, watch for red flags and risk factors. If it is present, always immediately evaluate for alternate diagnosis. If there are no red flags or risk factors, label them as episodic or multi-trigger wheeze based on the phenotypic presentation, and keep watching for qualifiers. Over a period of time, if there are qualifiers, still you can straight away, irrespective of age, call them as childhood asthma. If there are no qualifiers, persist to follow up. With follow up, you have no other alternative or wanting diagnosis, then still they could be inching towards childhood asthma. So we have to remember here, preschool wheeze, it doesn't mean that we should not utter the word of childhood asthma in a preschool age group. So we have to have certainty ruled out other diagnosis, or there should not be any other suspicion for any other alternative diagnosis. Then over a period of time, with the phenotypic background, with or without qualifiers, you can still call them as childhood asthma for want of appropriate treatment. Otherwise, we will not be treating them as they should be supposed to be handled with. So with regards to the management, recurrent episodes with or without qualifiers, what happens is any recurrent episodes, you can put them on low dose of inhaled corticosteroid, that is 200 micrograms per day of budesonide. And if there is good control, then you probably call them as asthma. You stop after 3 months. And if it is going to recur, you can restart on that. And previously, there was no clarity on the other wing. If it is not controlled, then probably what they thought was only alternative diagnosis. Here, I beg to differ, and the latest latest GINA have also addressed this aspect. If it is not controlled, evaluate and follow up, it could have an alternative diagnosis, or if there is no alternative diagnosis, it should still be a component of uncontrolled asthma. So here again, you treat them as asthma. So in preschool visas, even if you are inching towards calling them as asthma, first give a 3 months try, then you stop. If it happens again, you can start for 3 more months. And the second time or the third time, if it is going to happen again, with certainty, you can treat them as like your older children with asthma. So that's the overall difference in the management of preschool visas. And there are few changes what we need to know, which will not apply for preschool children for now. That is your MART, that is your maintenance and reliever therapy. In children over 6 years, now the people are of the view that we should not be using only beta 2 agonists in isolation in older children. And whenever a beta 2 agonist is being used, it has to be always in conjunction with the inhaled corticosteroids. So the MART, that is your single maintenance and reliever therapy, that is a fluticasone and budesonide combination. Here, the long acting component is only formoterol and not your salmeterol. And this can be used, or whenever you are not using the combination, when you use only beta 2 agonists, you have to also use separate inhaled corticosteroids in conjunction over that period of time. And children with mild asthma, previously intermittent asthma and mild persistent asthma was called as mild asthma. And now they say there is no difference, distinction between intermittent and mild persistent asthma, as both are at a risk of severe exacerbation. And this risk can be decreased with giving them inhaled corticosteroids. And children who are on high-dose inhaled corticosteroids and LABA are considered to be severe asthmatics. So that is a new definition which we have to know. And people who are already on high-dose inhaled corticosteroids and LABA, azithromycin 3 days a week can be added in uncontrolled patient. And they say this decreases exacerbation due to eosinophilic and non-eosinophilic asthma. And LAMA, that is your long-acting muscarinic anticholinergic, like your tiotropium and all, can be used after 6 years of age in people who are not controlled with high-dose inhaled corticosteroids and LABA. These are for older children, which I'm trying to enumerate. Now, a lot of talk is about COVID and asthma. And asthma medication, irrespective of whatever you have been prescribed, irrespective of COVID pandemic, you need not panic and stop away with them. You continue with your prescribed asthma medication the way they have to be. And there is no increased risk of COVID-19 in people with asthma unless they are having uncontrolled asthma or those who have had recent oral corticosteroids for an acute exacerbation. And flu vaccine is recommended for all asthmatics, more so in this pandemic. And the minimum of 2 week gap between flu and COVID vaccine is what has been recommended. And overall, many conditions causes wheezing and may mimic or coexist with asthma in younger age group. And noisy breathing are not synonymous with wheezing. And phenotypes vary with time, and it's not a watertight compartment. So I see the revolution over a period of time. Diagnosis is most of the time clinical, even in preschool children. Younger the child, greater the possibility of alternative diagnosis. That is the most important caveat which you have to remember. Think of alternate diagnosis always when there is an unusual symptom or a poor response. In either scenarios, think about an alternate diagnosis. Most of the time, you'll be able to pinpoint on one. Investigations are predominantly to rule out alternative diagnosis, only in rarest of rarest situation to confirm the diagnosis of asthma. There is no disease modifying therapy, meaning the treatment initiated is to have a good quality of life at that particular point in time and to have a normal growth and development, and not to modify the future happenings because of that disease. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sirvalan. I think Dr. Sobhalan has excellently covered under 5 E's, and is any questions? I think probably Sobhalan has touched most, not only under 5 E's as well as asthma. Sorry, are you hearing, Siva?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. And I think one question somebody asked that he already stressed that point. Any child with a recurrent VEs, kindly enlighten the ICS trial. I think he already sent upon that. You want to highlight, just you just to tell them, Siva.
See, with regards to asthma, it is a over a period of time diagnosis. So if you're not clear about if it is asthma or so, you can wait for the next episode to happen, but you cannot keep waiting endlessly years and months together to label them as asthma. So if there is any recurrent VEs without any alternative diagnosis, irrespective of age, you can put them on a trial of inhaled corticosteroids. That is a low dose, that is 100 microgram in the morning and evening with a spacer and a mask for 3 months. And if it is good on control, you can stop and see how it is. In future, if it is found wanting and the child continues to have recurrent VEs with infection or without infection, then probably we can restart on inhaled corticosteroids and go ahead in the way as we treat older individuals. Some people say second time give a 3 month trial and stop. And if it is found wanting the third time with no other alternative diagnosis, then treat them like older children with asthma. Have I answered the question, sir?
Yes, sir. I think Sobhalan has highlighted about the ICS trial, and he has broadly covered everything, mostly about the phenotypes and how it is confused and what should be followed according to the ERS guideline in under 5 E's. At one point of time, you should make a diagnosis of asthma. You should not miss it. And at that point onwards, you have to treat asthma, even though it is occurring below 5 years. I think its points are very well taken. And somebody is in between asked about the role of osmometry and all. I think I can advise them, say that till it is not validated. I think below 5 years, your clinical parameters are very, very important. Okay. He has been telling about the qualifiers and how the family history, personal history, and personal history of, he has also talked about that asthma, modified asthma predictive index. I think this will be very useful and all. I think I have not have any other questions from other side. And the last one thing, he has touched upon many things because he's a bronchoscopist. Sometimes even the VEs could be due to structural cause. Just to inquire about the structural causes, then I will wind up.
You are asking me, sir?
Yes, yes. You finished.
Yeah. Airway malacia, any noisy breathing, it can be associated with airway malacia. The upper airway malacia is your laryngeal malacia. The lower airway malacia is your bronchomalacia or your tracheal malacia. Meaning the upper airway malacias are quite obvious with regards to the external sound, whereas the lower airway malacias are more evident with your internal sound, like your wheezing. So here again, there is a common misconcept, like it's not a misconcept, there's a common belief that if there is a bronchomalacia, the 101% the cause of wheeze is due to bronchomalacia. That attains with severe certainty only if it is a persisting wheeze not responding to anything. Otherwise, here again, a child with bronchomalacia, if it is as an intermittent or a recurrent wheeze, meaning the child is normal in between, so bronchomalacia is there. Top and above, something is causing further constriction presenting like a wheeze. So here, irrespective of bronchomalacia, treat the wheeze as a wheeze it is for the merit of its recurrent presentation and not blame on the bronchomalacia alone to stop a controller therapy in the child. But it's true that in severe bronchomalacia, there can be paradoxical collapse of your airways with beta 2 agonist, causing further trigger to the extent of a sudden dropout like episode. But that will happen only if it is more than 75% collapsibility presenting with a persistent or a severe manifestation and not with recurrent manifestations.
Yes, I think already we are exceeding the limit. He also talked about the diethyl carboxylase. He warned about that not to use randomly and all. With this, I think if there is no questions, I'll call upon the next speaker, Dr. Sarath Balaji. I thank Dr. Sivabalan for his wonderful lecture.